हेलो फ्रेंड्स, गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन, गुड आफ्टरनून ऑल। सो आफ्टर अ लॉन्ग टाइम, सो आई एम टेकिंग क्लास। सो आई वाज इन्फेक्टेड विथ कोविड एंड यस, आई एम रिकवरिंग। स्टिल माइल्ड फेटिग एंड कॉफ इज देयर, बट अदरवाइज आई एम जस्ट रिकवरिंग। एंड मोर ओवर थैंक्स फॉर ऑल योर प्रेयर्स एंड ऑल योर सपोर्ट। So that was really great, and I'll try to. Yes, I'm now recovered here, majorly recovered, except for the dry cough and fatigue. So because of so much of antibiotics in the body, the side effects will be there, na? So that side effects only. Yes, fine. So my family, everyone has recovered. Everyone is all good. And we will be starting with the fast track batch, what we have stopped in the past. So I took 6 lectures. In that 6 lectures, I completed introduction, meaning of supply, and then exemptions. So these areas I have completed in the previous sessions. And exemptions, I think we need to discuss the practical questions. And even I shared one assignment also, I think I shared one assignment with you. So that assignment also I'm going to discuss. Okay. So let's see that. So we will see the practical questions in the exemptions chapter. See, in the last video, we completed the exemptions under GST. And now we are going to see the practical questions based on that exemptions. Okay, so that we will see now. We have few practical questions and MCQs. So mainly these MCQs are given in ICAI study material. So that MCQs we are discussing. You have become white, sir. Is it? Okay. White. I know what I have become. Okay, listen. Sahil, a resident of Delhi, is having a residential property in Vasant Vihar, Delhi, which has been given on rent to a family for rupees 50 lakh per annum. Determine whether Sahil is liable to pay GST on such rent. So what is your answer? What is the type of property? Residential property. The type of property is a residential property which is given on rent for what purpose? To a family. Means residential purpose. Residential property given on rent for residential purpose is exempted. Okay. So service by way of renting of residential property is exempt. Option B. Option B. Okay. So screen is not sharing. Why here? One second here. Yes. I think now it is properly visible. Say this. Sahil, a resident of Delhi, is having a residential property in Vasant Vihar, Delhi, which has been given on rent to a family for rupees 50 lakhs. So it's a residential property. Residential property given on rent for residential purpose is exempted. Okay. So therefore it is exempted. Which of the following service are exempt under GST? Which of the following service are exempt under GST? Testing of agricultural produce, supply of farm labor, warehousing of agricultural produce. See, any service in relation to agriculture or agricultural produce is exempted. So therefore, this is exempted. Supply of farm labor is also service in relation to agriculture, so exempted. Warehousing of agricultural produce is also exempted, because any service in relation to agriculture or agricultural produce is exempted. Due to that reason, these three are exempted. So option D, 1, 2 and 3, all these three are exempted. Okay. Then, Number three, Mr. Narayan Goyal has booked a room on rent in Sunshine Hotel for the purpose of lodging on 10th August. GST is not payable by Mr. Narayan Goyal in case value of the supply for the same is. So he booked a room on rent in Sunshine Hotel for the purpose of lodging. GST not payable. GST not payable if the value of supply is. See, renting of hotel rooms is exempted if the value of supply does not exceed how much per day? How much per day per room? 1000. So 1000 rupees. So therefore 800, option A. So value of supply, value of supply, value of supply less than or equals to rupees 1000 per day or equivalent. What is the meaning of equivalent? Equivalent means that suppose if the room is given on rent for say 7 days or 8 days or 1 month, then you need to convert it into per day. So that's the meaning of equivalent. Okay, so then it is exempted. So due to that reason, so 800 rupees only in the first case it is exempted, in all other cases it exceeds 1000 rupees. So there will be GST on that. And in exemptions, I asked you to remember, wherever the monetary limits come, once you cross that monetary limit, exemption is not available and entirely it will be taxable. Only one place, it is not like that. That is incubator services. Incubator providing services to incubator, 50 lakhs is exempted. Once we cross 50 lakhs, the remaining amount is only taxable, not entire amount. Only in that place, it is excess amount is only taxable. But in all other places, once there is a limit that is given, once you cross that limit, entirely it will be taxable. Okay. Then, number four, service or transportation of goods by dash are exempt from GST. Transportation of goods by road. Transportation of goods by road. Yes, it is exempted. Other than by GTA or courier agency. Okay. Transportation of goods by road other than GTR courier agency, because GTR and courier agency will always be taxable. Of course, we have few exemptions, but in many cases taxable, but other transportation of goods by road other than these two is exempted. Inland waterways is also exempted. So therefore, what is the option? So it is option D, transportation of goods by road. Please listen carefully. What generally students will write, 1 and 2 like that they will write. But that is wrong. That is wrong. Because this 1 is subject to 2. 1 is subject to 2. GTA and courier agency, which means transportation of goods by road other than GTA and courier agency. That's what. 1 except 3 and 4 and 2. That is only correct option. Okay. Then transportation of dash by rail from Chennai to Gujarat are exempt from GST. Pulses, yes, exempted. Military equipments, yes, exempted. Electric equipments, no. Electric equipments is not. Jaggery. Jaggery is also not an agricultural produce, correct? Is jaggery an agricultural produce? No, jaggery is not an agricultural produce. Even it will not come under food grains, including flours, pulses, milk and salt. So nowhere it will come. So only 1 and 2. So option A. Okay, option A. Then point number 6, services by way of warehousing of dash is exempt from GST. Services by way of warehousing of dash is exempt from GST. Tea, jaggery, betel leaves, processed cashew nuts. Okay, what is your answer? Service by way of warehousing of. Sir, warehousing of tea. See, tea is not an agricultural produce. But, see, even though tea is not an agricultural produce, but there are some goods. Even though not agricultural produce, but its warehousing is exempted. So in that, tea, jaggery, betel leaves and processed cashew nuts, all these are covered. Even though these are not agricultural produce, even though these are not agricultural produce, but its storage is exempted. Its storage is exempted. Is it clear? See, there are some goods. If it is agricultural produce, no doubt it is exempted. They are storing of agricultural produce, warehousing of agricultural produce, for that whatever charges that you collect is anyhow exempted. Warehousing of agricultural produce is exempted. But when there are some goods, even though it is not agricultural produce, but these goods are exempted. These are that list: tea and coffee, then cashew nuts, then raw vegetable fibers such as jute, flax, etc. And then we have jaggery. And then beetle leaves. So all these, even though not agricultural produce, but it is exempted. Okay. Then, so therefore, what is the option? All B. Option B is the answer. Very good. Which of the following service are not exempt? See, when you read in MCQs questions, please be careful. Sometimes they will give which of the following are exempted, which of the following are not exempted, which of the following are correct, which of the following are incorrect. So you need to be careful what is asked. You accordingly need to select the answer. Okay. So which of the following are not exempt? Not exempt. Yoga camp conducted by a charitable trust registered under 12A of the Income Tax Act. Actually, it is exempted because yoga will come under charitable activities. Advancement of religion, spirituality, and yoga. It will come under charitable activities. Therefore, it is exempted. Services provided by business correspondent to the rural branch of the bank with respect to savings bank account. Business facilitator or business correspondent working for a rural area branch of the bank is exempted. Correct? So this is also exempted. Services provided by cord blood bank for preservation of stem cells. Yes, health services we discussed. So that is service by preservation of stem cells. That is also exempted. Then D, service provided by commentator. Actually, commentator is not there in the list. Only five people are there. Who are they? Individual as a player, referee, umpire, coach, team manager. Only five people. Player, referee, umpire, coach, team manager. All others are taxable. So this is taxable. Option D is the answer. Option D is the answer. Okay. Then, non-processed cashew, is it an agricultural produce? Yes, non-processed cashew is an agricultural produce. Raw, that is actually cashew fruit. Cashew nut fruit is there, na? So that will be raw cashew nut will be coming under agricultural produce. But processed is not agricultural produce, but its storage is exempted. Then, which of the following are exempt from GST? Which of the following are exempt from GST? Services by an artist by way of performance in classical art form of painting or sculpture making. Painting or sculpture making is not exempted. Painting or sculpture making will be taxable. Service by an artist by way of performance in modern art forms. Modern art forms is also taxable. So it should be classical art form of music, dance, and theater. Service by an artist by way of performance in folk. Yes, folk or classical art form of music, dance, theater, where the consideration thereof exceeds 1.5. That is also taxable. Actually, consideration should not exceed 1,50,000 per performance. Per performance, it should not exceed 1,50,000. So point number D, services by an artist by way of performance in the folk or classical art form of music, dance, theater, with consideration thereof not exceeding 1.5 lakhs. That is only exempted. Option D. Okay. Then next, services by way of admission to Dash is not exempt from GST. Not exempt. They are asking not exempt. Not exempt. Sir, museum, irrespective of the ticket price, it is exempted. National park, tiger reserve, these three, irrespective of the ticket price, it is exempted. Whereas, recognized sporting event where the admission ticket cost is 600 rupees per person, it exceeds 500. So, when it exceeds 500, it will be taxable. See, admission to certain events like award function, recognized sporting event, pageant, then musical performance, concert, circus, planetarium. So these entry tickets is exempted provided the ticket price does not exceed 500 rupees per person. But in this case, it is 600. So it exceeds 500. Then entirely it will be taxable. Is it clear? Then next, warehousing of Dash is exempt from GST. Warehousing of Dash is exempt from GST. What is exempt from GST? Warehousing of what is exempt from GST? Rice is exempt from GST? Yes. Minor forest produce is yes. Jaggery, yes. Coffee, yes. These are all there. Rice, even though not agriculture produce, but warehousing of rice is specifically exempted. Packing, loading, unloading, and warehousing of rice is exempted. Minor forest produce, that also we discussed, raw honey, bamboo, etc. So which are not agricultural produce, but its warehousing is exempted. Jaggery and coffee is given in the list of goods, even though it is not agricultural produce, but its warehousing is exempted. So all the cases, all the cases. We are importing oxygen medicines from other countries, whether it will be taxable. Yes, it is taxable here. We don't have any exemption. So that is actually goods. Goods related exemption we don't have in syllabus. But even otherwise, I am just telling you that these goods are not exempted. They have taxed. So that's where Nirmala Chechi, many people are trolling her that why are you not exempting that? Why are you not exempting that? So even Indian manufactured vaccines, sanitizers, etc. are taxable. Even import of oxygen and vaccines are taxable. Okay, chargeable to customs duty. Import of goods are chargeable to customs duty, but they have reduced the rates. Government has reduced the rates. Reducing the rates is not the point. It is like completely it should be exempted. Okay. And of course, I don't want to talk about much about it because now government also don't know what they are doing. You know, they are doing something, so they really do not understand what to do because the number of cases are increasing like that. So it's out of control. It's out of the control. So only God should save. But here, trust me, as I have recovered from COVID, I'm sharing my experience. Terribilities. Terribilities. If 10 people hit you, how you feel? That much tiredness you will feel. That much pain you will feel. And really, your throat and chest congestion will be high. So, not able to breathe that easily. And cough will be like throughout the night for 4 hours, 5 hours, you will be getting cough. Even after medicines, and mine is mild COVID, actually mild to moderate, 18. So 18 is mild to moderate COVID. So that itself, beyond 35 means no COVID. So for that itself, so out of experience, I am telling, maybe if I heard of, that could be different. Out of experience, I am telling. So maybe because we are young, we can escape. But what if we are not? That's where many people are dying. Many people who are weak and their immune system is weak, they are dying. So it's really, really very pathetic disease. Actually, I was thinking as to from how it got. You know, we never went outside, and even I did not take classes face to face. From long time, I was at home, but somehow it came. So therefore, it is like how much ever precautions you take, you know, it is coming. Only mistake what we did is some relatives came to our house, we allowed them, and they were tested positive. From there, my kids got that, and from my kids, we got. So therefore, it just transfers like anything crazily. So try to understand, really be safe. Okay. So therefore, out of that experience, I am sharing this with you. Fine. Okay. So therefore, your doubt, import of oxygen and other vaccines, etc., is coming under customs duty, not under GST. Because that is import of goods. Import of goods is not under the ambit of GST, no? That's under the ambit of customs duty. Fine. So see this. Question number 11. Which of the following services are exempt from GST? Admission to circus where entry ticket cost is 550 rupees per person. Admission to a circus. Circus is given in the list. Yes, it's given in the list. But the ticket is 550. So the question is, which of the following are exempt? This is not exempt. This is taxable. Interest charged on outstanding credit card balances. Interest is exempted. Like that, we will think. Like that, we should not think. Wrong answer. So it is taxable. Interest charged on outstanding credit card. See, all interests are exempted other than interest involved in credit cards. All interest or discount is exempted other than interest involved in credit cards. Okay. Services by an organizer to any person in respect of a business exhibition held in India is taxable. Suppose if the business exhibition is held outside India, it is exempted. I told you, because of keeping the business exhibition outside India, our products get promoted and we get the export orders. That's the reason why business exhibition, if held outside India, they are exempting. But the business exhibition held in India, we don't have any exemption. Services by foreign diplomatic mission located in India, yes, it is exempted. Who are that foreign diplomatic mission? Embassy, consulates, UN organizations, etc. Their outward supply is exempted. Okay. So option D is the answer. Okay. Same condition for me, sir. Just now I am recovered. Okay, Srinivasan, take care here. But post-recovery, traumas are there. Okay, you will not. But I don't know whether everyone have the same. But still, the cough is not reducing for me. So maybe because I'm taking classes, I'm getting this much of cough. I don't know. But still, so if I take continuously, if I start speaking continuously for half an hour, cough will come. Okay. So maybe because of teaching, I don't know. Which of the following is treated as exempt supply under the CGST Act? Sale of liquor. Sir, treated as exempted supply. Exempt supply. Sale of liquor. Sale of liquor is what? Non-taxable supply. Non-taxable supply will come under exempt supply. Correct or not? Yes, it is coming under exempt supply. Supply of healthcare services. Yes, it comes under exempt supply. Transmission of electricity by an electricity transmission utility. Exempt supply. So option D. But many students will answer this as option C. Sale of liquor is non-taxable supply. So they will leave it. They will leave it and they will answer only 2 and 3. Healthcare services and transmission of electricity. And actually, they will end up with the wrong answer because we need to be strong. That's why I'm telling you we need to be strong on the subject. Alcoholic liquor for human consumption is non-taxable supply. And what is the meaning of exempted supply? Exempted supply includes non-taxable supply. So therefore, if even though it is a non-taxable supply will come under exempt supply and it is an exempted supply. So option D is the answer for that. Okay. Next. ICAI module, it is given that Indian national flag and plastic bangles are exempted. The reason for exemption. See, actually, you don't have to remember the list of goods which are exempted because ICAI has given a notification stating that the list of goods which are exempted is not for exam. That is general knowledge sake only. So therefore, I'm not spending much time onto that discussion about goods. About service only is important from exam point of view. Okay. And reason for exemption with respect to some goods is maybe they feel like these are necessities. So necessities they don't want to tax because if they tax the necessities, the price of that product will increase for that reason. Okay. Then point number 13. Which of the following is a recognized system of medicine for the purpose of exemption from healthcare services? Healthcare service in recognized system of medicine is exempted. Allopathy, is it recognized? Yes, allopathy is English medicines. Yes, recognized. Unani and Siddha, yes. All these three are recognized system of medicines here. All these three are recognized system of medicine. Sir, what are the system of medicines which are not recognized in India? There is something called as Reiki healing treatments and pranic healing treatments. Reiki healing treatments. Reiki healing are pranic healing, Reiki healing or pranic healing or Nityananda treatments, okay, are not recognized in India, are not recognized system of medicine, okay, because Nityananda will say that if you are facing any issue, you hug me. So that all your health issues and all will be gone. Okay. So those are all not recognized system of medicines in India for your information. Okay. Then, which of the following service is exempt under healthcare service provided by clinical establishments? Which of the following service is exempt under healthcare service? See this. Chemist shop in a hospital selling medicines to public at large. Is it exempt? Chemist shop in a hospital? No. Are they selling to inpatients? Only when they sell it to the inpatients, it is exempted. Otherwise, it will be taxable. Only when they sell it to inpatients, it is exempted. Otherwise, it is taxable. Who are inpatients? Inpatients are those who are admitted in the hospital. Food supplied from an outsourced canteen to inpatients as per a diet prescribed by the hospital dietitian. Outsource the canteen to inpatients. Okay, so yes, it is exempted. So food, sale of food to inpatients is exempted. Food supplied from an outsourced canteen in a hospital to visitors and attendants. No, that is taxable. That is taxable. Because only to inpatients it is exempted. Visitors, outpatients, or attendants, or visitors, or staff, etc. That will be taxable. Advertisement service provided by hospital to a pharmaceutical company for their asthma pump by displaying it prominently in hospital building. Nowhere it is healthcare service. Where is it healthcare service here? So that's not at all covered under healthcare service and it will be taxable. Okay. So only one is exempted, that is B. Then next. Baba Ramdev treatment. I don't know here what Baba Ramdev is doing treatment. I don't know. So but yoga is exempted. Actually Baba Ramdev treatment is yoga, na? Yoga is exempted because it's a recognized system of medicine. Then service by acupuncture. Acupuncture is also recognized there. Acupuncture is also recognized. So these are the MCQs given in ICI study material related to exemptions. Then some questions already we discussed. Some questions already we discussed. I think, yes. Now look into question number one, second part. First part already we completed, second part. Mr. Vikal, a performing artist. Mr. Vikal, a performing artist, has received 1,58,000 for performance of classical dance and 90,000 from acting in TV serial. Acting in TV serial will always be taxable. Why acting in TV serial is taxable? By acting in TV serial, they torture us a lot. So let them pay tax. So that is taxable. Okay. So TV serials are something which is so stupid. So same scene, it will go for 20 minutes. So various expressions. One thinks something will happen. So husband will scold wife. Husband reaction, wife reaction, mother-in-law's reaction, father-in-law's reaction, neighbor's reaction, and the kid in the family's reaction. Ayoyo. So that Indian serial, people who act in that, even if they receive 1 rupee also, they should pay tax. That's good. Because they are torturing us a lot for that reason. Okay. Next. What about this performing artist? Yes, they are really putting some effort. So performing artist, but 1,58,000, it exceeds 1,50,000. So that will be taxable. That will be taxable because it exceeds 1,50,000, nah, due to that reason. Sir, entirely taxable? Yes, entirely taxable. Then, sir, outsourced canteen should be interpreted in a way like canteen is given on rent by the hospital. Exactly. Should be treated like not rent. So actually hospital has to provide the food, but which is given by the outsourced canteen. That way we will treat. Then, next, sir, outsourced food. So whether food supplies to inpatient or outpatient, it is taxable, na, sir? See, outsourced food means it is like they outsourced it to one canteen, and if the canteen is providing the food, that is taxable. But hospital has to provide the food, but that food they have outsourced and it has been cooked and delivered to the hospital, and hospital is giving to the inpatients. That is exempted. That's the point there. Okay. Then, sir, what are the medicines you have taken? Better to consult a doctor. So some antibiotics, I think Fabiflu, like that, some medicine. Fabiflu, then some medicines, I don't remember that and earlier. If you ask me GST related information, I will remember and tell. Medicines and all, I don't know, sir. Then see this. Question number two. Examine whether GST is exempted on the following independent supply of services. Tejan company, a tour operator, provides service to a foreign tourist in relation to a tour wholly conducted outside India. Yes, it is exempted. We discussed this. There is a tour operator boss. Where the tour operator is in? India. He is providing tour operator services to whom? To a foreign national. Where the tour is conducted? Fully outside India. Then it is exempted. then it is exempted. Okay, say that. So the same is exempted, but here in this case, to whom it is provided or where the tour is conducted, the tour is conducted in Jammu and Kashmir. So if the tour is conducted fully outside India only, it is exempted, but the tour is conducted in Jammu and Kashmir, therefore it is taxable. The tour is conducted in Jammu and Kashmir, therefore the same is not exempt. Then question number 3, second point. Kayan Enterprises, an event organizer, provided service to Breathing Wall Limited by way of organizing business exhibition at Pradhan Pragati Maidan in New Delhi as a part of Make in India initiative. Sir, it is taxable, sir. Why? Sir, where the exhibition is held? The exhibition is held in India. So if the exhibition is held outside India, it is exempted. But if the exhibition is held in India, it will be taxable. Okay. Then next, look into this. So actually, this question has got a connection with liability to pay GST. So that liability to pay GST, once we discuss, then we will discuss this question number 4. Okay. So this question number 4 is related to liability to pay GST. We'll complete the discussion and come back to this. Question number 5 we completed. Question number 6. Actually, question number 6 is related to supply. We all know that consideration excludes donations, unconditional donations. So donations are divided into two: conditional donation and unconditional donation. Conditional donation is treated as supply and unconditional donation is not treated as supply, correct? Now, when the name of a person is displayed, say we receive some donation and we are displaying the name of the person. Now that name promotes the business of that person. Because of displaying the name, the business of the person is promoted, or there is some business advantage to that person. So then it will be treated like a conditional donation and treated as consideration and supply. Okay. So this question is related to that only. The temple of ancestral deity of Mr. Aman Goyal and his family is located Berry, Haryana. The temple is run by a charitable organization registered under the Section 12A of the Income Tax Act 1961. The family has got unshakable faith in their ancestral deity. Okay, and Mr. Raman is a big entrepreneur having flourishing business of tiles in Gurugram. Upon the birth of the first child, he donated 10 lakhs to the said temple for construction of the sitting hall in the temple. On the main door of the sitting hall, the nameplate was placed stating, donated by Mr. Aman Goyal upon birth of first child. So anywhere this is leading to business advantage of Aman Goyal because of displaying this name, any business advantage is there? No, because nowhere the business name or the impression is formed. So therefore, it will not bring any business advantage. Due to that reason, it is treated like an unconditional donation and it is not a supply. Okay. Now, say for example, you are mentioning Sachin Tendulkar. So now, will there be any business advantage? No. So it is not a supply. You are mentioning Sachin Tendulkar, cricketer, ex-cricketer. Now, will there be any business advantage? Yes, there will be business advantage. Okay, so generally you try to understand individual name, business name, but what is the logic behind that individual name, business name? Because of putting that name, there is some business advantage derived. So then it will be Bill Gates, no business advantage. Bill Gates, CEO Microsoft Incorporation, definitely business advantage is there. You understood or not? Then that is about question number 6. Sir, please explain excluded from supply versus exempted supply. See, excluded from supply means there are some activities spelled slow. Those activities are excluded from supply. Spelled slow we discussed now in 7 subsection 2. Sovereign functions of government, post actionable claims other than lottery, betting, gambling, legal fees, fee collected by court or tribunal. That spelled slow is excluded from supply. But what we are discussing in this chapter is exempted by way of notification. These are known as exempted supply, means these are covered under supply, but it is exempted by way of notification. That is the difference. Okay. Excluded from supply means it is not at all a supply. There is no levy at all. But exempted supply means there is levy, but it is exempted for the time being. So as and when the exemption is withdrawn, it will be taxable. That is the meaning. Okay. Then next, Sir, sorry to ask in public domain. Can you tell which doctor you have consulted? So, can you please message me? I will tell you the doctor details. Okay, fine. Then, if hospital rents its own premises on rent for canteen and if the canteen provides food either to inpatients or outpatients, is taxable? Yes. So, if there is a hospital, that hospital is giving their premises on rent for a canteen. Now they will receive rent. The rent will be taxable. That canteen will be supplying the food. That will also be taxable. Very simple. Okay. Next. Next one here. Look into question number 7. Holiday guest house situated at Shimla provides boarding and lodging service to tourists at economical cost. The charges of a single deluxe room per day 999 exempted. Per day it is 999 exempted. Mr. X has booked one deluxe room for 2 days during Christmas holidays. You are required to determine whether GST is payable by holiday guest house on the above booking. No, it is exempted. Then, will your answer change if the charges for single deluxe room per day charged by the holiday guest house is 1000 rupees? Then also it is exempted. Because the exemption is available if it is less than or equal to 1000 rupees. Previously it was less than 1000 rupees per day, but now it is less than or equal to 1000 rupees per day. But precincts of a religious place, surroundings of the religious place given on rent, there it is exempted. Accommodation is exempted if per day it is less than 1000. There it is less than, not equal to. Equal to will be taxable. Equal to 1000 will be taxable. Less than 1000 is only exempted. Okay. But normal cases, less than or equals to 1000 is exempted. Then, sir, in most of the answers, there is circular number. So is it important for us to do the same in exam? No. Circular numbers, you don't have to remember in exam. Because if you can remember the circular number, better remember the section numbers and write those section numbers. So rather than remembering the circular numbers, because practically no one can remember the circular numbers. So then, sir, what is that I need to write? If you know that this information is from a circular, you can write as per CBIC circular. If you know that information is from a circular, you can write as per CBIC circular. But otherwise, you can just write the said activity is exempted. Explain that activity and it is exempted. Okay. Then question number 8. Messrs. Damodar Limited provides services by way of storage of seasonal fruits and vegetables. Seasonal fruits and vegetables are agricultural produce, and service by way of storage of agricultural produce is exempted. Okay. Monthly rent for the godown is 15,000. Examine whether GST is payable by Messrs. Damodar Limited. No, it is exempted. Even otherwise, there are some list of goods. In that list of goods also fruits and vegetables are specified. So therefore, that way also it is exempted. So this explanation, either you can write this explanation, alternatively, you can write another explanation that service in relation to agricultural produce, service in relation to agricultural produce, service in relation to agricultural produce is exempted. Even that point also you can write. Okay. Then, sir, one request, can you write how to write it in the exam? Simple here. First, what you need to do, for example, you take this question. This question itself you take. You get this question. Now you need to start with any service provided in relation to agricultural produce is exempted wide notification number 12/2017. All exemptions are under notification 12/2017. All exemptions are under notification 12/2017. Section 11 read with notification number 12/2017. All exemption services, all exempted services. So you can write reference. So you remember a 4-point approach for presentation. So ensure that these 4 points are touched upon. Okay. Not that you have to write the side headings like that, but these four points should be touched upon. First, you need to give a reference. So any chapter, any exemption, any question on exemptions, any question on exemption, you write as per section 11 of CGST Act, read with notification number 12/2017, like that you write. Okay, reference as per section 11, read with notification number 12/2017. Okay, that's a reference. Any question, you start that way. Then next, provision you write. Provision you write. What is the provision here? As per section 11 of CGST Act, read with notification number 12/2017, any service in relation to agricultural produce is exempted. Agricultural produce means a primary produce out of agriculture on which no processing is carried out. Okay, that is a provision. Now, discussion. You make the discussion. In the present case, fruits and vegetables are agricultural produce. Fruits and vegetables are agricultural produce. And storage and warehousing of such agricultural produce is service in relation to agricultural produce. Therefore, it is exempted. Conclusion. Therefore, it is exempted. So now a paragraph is created. Now that will give a good impression. Okay. Like that, every question you follow the same style. So for every question, the reference is common. What is a common reference you need to give? What is a common reference? You remember today? So what is a common reference that you need to give? So you need to start it like as per section. As per section 11, read with, as per section 11, 11 of which act, CGST Act, read with notification number 12/2017, notification number 12/2017, okay, like that you can write, done. Then, question number 9. Decide which person is liable to pay GST in the following independent cases where the recipient is located in the taxable territory. Ignore the aggregate turnover and the exemption that is available. Decide which person is liable to pay GST in the following independent cases where the recipient is located in the taxable territory. Okay, first, Mr. Raghu provided sponsorship service. Actually, this question is liability to pay GST. So that is the next chapter. We'll complete that and we will come back to this. Liability to pay GST. We have not yet discussed that due to that reason. Then other questions. Question number 11, 12 we discussed. 13 also done. Yes. 14 also done. 15 completed. 16. 15 completed na? 15 is completed. No, 15 is not completed. See that. Mr. Teeraj, a registered supplier of service in Bengaluru, has provided the following information for the month of February 2018. Intrastate taxable supply of service, 5 lakh 20. Yes, we need to pay GST on that, and it is intrastate taxable, so therefore we need to pay CGST and SGST. See, whenever the question says, whenever the question asks, compute the GST payable, never generalize it. Never write single GST. So check whether in the question you can find intrastate and interstate supplies. Then put a table. Particulars, CGST, SGST and IGST. And properly you show that. Okay, like this. Particulars, value of supply, CGST, SGST and IGST. Like that you need to show, compute the amounts and put it in the respective column. So please follow this. Okay. So first one, taxable, 5 lakh 20, and it is an intrastate supply. So there will be CGST and SGST. So therefore, 5 lakh 20 into 9% CGST, 5 lakh 20 into 9% SGST, like that. And then legal fee paid to a lawyer located within the state. Legal fee paid to a lawyer located within the state. We paid. That is, this person paid. Teeraj has paid. This will be taxable under RCM. Correct? So that will be taxable. That will be taxable because we need to see Teeraj's turnover during the previous year. Services provided by an individual advocate. Services provided by an individual advocate or firm of advocate to a business entity whose turnover during the previous year exceed the threshold limit is taxable. So here we don't know whether it will be like, what is the turnover of Dheeraj? We don't know what is the turnover of the Dheeraj. He's a registered supplier. So we take that the aggregate turnover during the previous year exceeds threshold limit. So that view we will take, then it will be taxable. But actually it is outward supply or inward supply. This is inward supply. The first one is outward supply. The first one is outward supply, whereas the second one is inward supply. And this inward supply is covered under RCM. We will be learning it in reverse charge mechanism. What are covered under RCM? There it is covered. Then rent paid to state government for his office building. This is also inward supply. And this is also taxable. Government services. Services provided by government. Renting of immovable property service to a business entity whose turnover during previous year exceed threshold limit will be taxable. Okay. And these two will come under RCM. Second and third will come under RCM. Vishnu, very good. Then four, received for services towards conduct of exams in Laval University, Pune. Exams recognized by law being an intrastate, interstate transaction. Sir, this is outward. This is outward. And this is exempted. Why this is exempted, I will tell you. Services by way of conduct of examination. Services provided to educational institution by way of conduct of examination of such educational institution is exempted, correct or not? Therefore, under that category, it is exempted. So, that's how you are showing. Outward supplies two. One is taxable, one is exempted. Inward supplies on which GST payable under RCM. And tax liability. And you know what? There is some credit balance information given here. No, not given. But remember, whatever GST that you pay under RCM, you have to pay by cash only. You cannot use a credit balance for payment of GST under RCM. Hope you know that. Whatever GST you pay under RCM, you have to pay by cash. So this GST under RCM is there na, that needs to be paid by cash. This 1800 and 2700, we need to pay by cash. And whatever we pay under RCM, we can take it as credit and adjust against the normal liability. So what is this 1800 plus 2700? If you see 4500. So first we need to pay this 4500. And it will be adjusted with the normal liability. What is the normal liability? 46,800 is there, na? From this 46,800, this 4,500 will be adjusted. See this. From that 46,800, this 4,500 will be adjusted. So remaining 42,300 will be the GST liability on outward supply. So this can be paid using credit ledger. You understood? Whereas this 4,500 and 4,500 should be paid using cash ledger. Of course, the total liability will be 46,800 only, no change. Total liability will be 46,800. But you know what in exam students will do? What they will do? They will write tax liability 51,300 and return accordance 51,300. My answer is correct, like that they will say. But they will not get one mark also. Total tax liability is not 51,300. Okay, please be careful with respect to this. It is not 51,300. Every student will make a mistake. 51,300 liability. No. 51,300 is not liability. I'll tell you how. First 4,500 we need to pay. That can be taken as credit. Next month or same month. Same month we can take as credit. Same month we can take as credit and adjust against outward liability. FCM liability. Okay, so therefore, what is our FCM liability? 46,800. So from 46,800, we can reduce 4,500. So 42,300 is the outward supply liability plus RCM liability 4,500. So 46,800 is the net GST liability. So because of showing this extra computation only, you will be given marks. Understood? So if this question is for 4-mark question, if it is a 4-mark question, you will get 4 out of 4 only when you write this. This is that much crucial. And maybe because of writing that it is taxable and exempted, you may get 2 marks. Okay, if you need to get full marks, please be careful wherever this RCM is coming. Next, question number 16. Determine the taxable value of supply under GST law with respect to each of the following independent services provided by the registered persons. Fee charged for yoga camp conducted by a charitable trust registered under section 12A of the Income Tax Act. What is this? Taxable or exempted? Fee charged for yoga camp conducted by a charitable trust registered under 12A of the Income Tax Act. What is your answer with respect to this 50,000? It is, come on, exempted. It is exempted. 12AA, yoga, charitable activity. Then, amount charged by business correspondent from banking company for the services provided to the rural branch of a bank with respect to savings bank accounts. Okay, so business correspondent to rural area, again, exempted. Then, amount charged by cord blood bank for preservation of stem cells, exempted. Somewhere already we discussed this question, correct? But without numbers we discussed. Now we are discussing with numbers. So, one MTP question. So, one MTP question of November 2019 asked as an exam question. Okay. So, that's why RTP questions and MTP questions are very important, because that will be literally ditto coming in the exam. Okay, so 5,20,000 commentator will be taxable. So in this case, only 5,20,000 will be taxable. Okay, so with this we completed all the questions related to exemptions under GST given in the book. These are all the past exam questions, MTP and RTP questions related to exemptions chapter. Okay, now I think I gave one assignment. I don't know whether you have done that or not. So whether you did that assignment, I gave one assignment related to import of services, OIDR services, etc. I gave one assignment. Have you done that? I don't know whether you have completed it or not. So that assignment is shared in the Google Drive. I don't know whether you have completed that or not. So maybe today you can go through that. Assignment number two. So you can go through that, and next class I will discuss the answers related to that assignment. Okay, and now we are moving on to the next chapter, next concept block number 4, liability to pay GST. Generally, who will be having liability to pay GST to government? Who will have liability to pay GST to government generally? Generally, liability to pay GST to government is on whom? Generally, liability to pay GST to government lies with supplier. But there are three exceptional cases. And those exceptions are given in 9 subsection 3, 9 subsection 4, and 9 subsection 5. Got it? Generally, liability to pay GST is on supplier to government. Liability to pay GST to government lies with supplier. But there are exceptions. And what is the meaning of exceptions means? Supplier will not pay GST to government, some other person will pay GST to government. Those exceptions are only given in section 9 subsection 3, 9 subsection 4, and 9 subsection 5. As per section 9 subsection 3, there are some notified goods and services. With respect to those notified goods and services, liability to pay GST is on recipient. That is known as RCM. 9 subsection 4, that is, also, 9 subsection 4 also, when the supplier is unregistered and the recipient is registered, then in that case, liability to pay GST is on recipient, that is also called as RCM. So, 9.3 and 9.4 both are called as RCM, whereas 9.5 e-commerce operator, when the supplies are made through e-commerce operator, liability to pay GST is on the e-commerce operator with respect to notified services. Now, what is it we are trying to understand is, first, what are the notified services, goods and services for 9.3? First 9.3, I'm taking 9.3. What is 9.3? So there are notified goods and notified services, sir. With respect to that notified goods and notified services, who will pay GST? Recipient will pay GST under reverse charge mechanism. Okay, clear, understood or not? Now, what are those notified goods? Those notified goods are not in syllabus. So leave it. Those notified goods, what are the list of notified goods on which 9 subsection 3 is applicable, where liability to pay GST is on RCM is not in syllabus? So leave it. But what are the notified services is applicable, and these notified services are given in notification number 13 2017. So these services are there, na, notified services for RCM. So this list of services can be remembered with a keyword, sir CG got salads, sir CG got salads, and that notification number is 13 2017. Please write down the notification number. 12 2017 is what? Exemptions. 12-2017 is exemptions. Notification 13-2017 is reverse charge mechanism. Okay. So there are some notified services. With respect to these notified services, liability to pay GST is on recipient. Okay. And in that, we are starting one by one. First, we are understanding what is the service, who is the supplier, who is the recipient, and what are the conditions, so that we will know when it will come under RCM. And if we have any related exemptions, that related exemptions also I am going to connect. Okay, first. Security lending as per SEBI. Security lending as per SEBI. That is a service. In that, who is the supplier? Lender of the securities. Who is the recipient? Borrower of the securities. Any conditions? No conditions. Who will pay GST? Borrower of the securities will pay GST. Is it clear? So three things you need to remember here. What is the service? Who is the supplier? Who is the recipient? And conditions. Okay. Clear or not? And the connecting exemptions, if any. So related to this, any exemptions? Are there no exemptions? Related to this, there are no exemptions. There are no exemptions related to this. Okay, there are no exemptions related to this. So what is the service? Security lending. Who is the supplier of service? Lender of securities. Who is the recipient of service? Borrower of securities. Who should pay GST to government? Borrower of securities should pay GST to government. Any conditions? No conditions. Any exemptions? No exemptions. Done. So sir, yes I are. In that, yes, we completed I for import of services. In case of import of services, import of services already we discussed in detail. Divide into two. What is that? OIDR other than OIDR. OIDR services imported by non-taxable recipient other than non-taxable recipient. Imported by non-taxable recipient will be taxable under FCM. Imported by other than non-taxable recipient will be taxable under RCM. Whereas other than OIDR services, imported by non-taxable recipient is exempted. Other than non-taxable recipient will be taxable under RCM. So we discussed that in exemptions. Okay. So we have connected this in the exemptions chapter itself. So please go to the exemptions chapter. In that, one second, you can go to the exemptions chapter. In that exemptions chapter, this import of services, OIDR services, we discussed a chart. Where is that here? Yes, page number 59. So you write here, refer page number 59. Refer page number 59. Refer page number 59. So in page number 59, you can see that. In page number 59, you can see that. Okay. So we discussed OIDR service, other than OIDR service, what is the tax implication, etc. Say this. Import of service, OIDR, other than OIDR, OIDR by non-taxable recipient is taxable under FCM. other than non-taxable recipient will be taxable under RCM. Other than OIDR service, if it is imported by non-taxable recipient, is exempted. Other than non-taxable recipient will be taxable. Related to this only, assignment 2 I have given. Related to this only, I have given an assignment 2. Assignment 2 in the Google Drive, you can see. Assignment 2 in the Google Drive, you can see. And please go through the assignment 2 and try that questions today. Don't forget. So today you have to complete that, because tomorrow I am going to discuss that assignment answers. Okay. Done. Done here. Clear. Then. So go back to the list of services covered under RCM. So yes, security lending you understood. Security lending, who is a supplier? Supplier is lender of securities. Recipient is borrower of securities. Liability to pay GST is on borrower of securities. Okay. Whereas I, import of services, who is the supplier? Supplier located outside India. Recipient is located in India. In one case it is exempted, in other case it will be taxable under RCM and FCM accordingly. Then R, renting of motor vehicles. Related to renting of motor vehicles, we saw few exemptions. What are the exemptions that we saw related to renting of motor vehicles? Hope you remember. Renting of movable property, immovable property, page number 55. Refer page number 55. See, I am just giving you the interlinking provision so that you can refer the exemptions and then you can learn the RCM also for that reason. Refer page number 55. Refer page number 55. So what is that? What are the three renting of motor vehicles which is exempted? What are the three renting of motor vehicles? First one, renting of motor vehicles designed to, like, having a capacity to carry more than 12 passengers given on rent to state road transport undertaking is exempted. Then electric motor vehicle having capacity to transport more than 12 passengers given to a local authority, exempted. Then hiring of a means of transport to carry goods. Hiring of means of transport to carry goods. So is given on rent to a GTA. These three renting is exempted. First is motor vehicle that can carry more than 12 passengers given on rent to a state transport undertaking. Second, electric motor vehicle. Attacking capacity more than 12 passengers given on rent to whom? Local authority. Third, motor vehicle transporting goods, lorries, trucks, etc. given on rent to GTA. These three renting of motor vehicle is exempted. Now one more renting of motor vehicle is exempted, which we saw in education services. What is that? In education services, we saw renting of motor vehicle to an education, that to a person who provides transportation service to an educational institution. So first, we are giving motor vehicle on rent to a person. That person provides transportation service to category 1 educational institution. Then it is exempted. That renting is exempted. So that is the renting which we have discussed. Apart from that renting, all other renting of motor vehicles will be taxable, correct? Wherever it is taxable, wherever that renting of motor vehicles is taxable, if it is, wherever that renting of motor vehicles is taxable, if three conditions are satisfied, then it will be RCM. What are those three conditions? Supplier should be other than body corporate. Recipient should be body corporate. And the rate of GST should be 5%. Then it will be coming under RCM. Is it clear? Supplier should be other than body corporate. Recipient should be body corporate. And the rate of GST should be 5%. Then only it will be coming under RCM. Otherwise, it will be FCM. Okay. So today, actually, I will give you assignment 3 also. Assignment 2, I gave it long back. I don't know whether you solved it or not. So that's why I'm just giving you one day time for you. So today you need to try assignment 2. And one more assignment also I will be sharing with you today. That is assignment number 3. Assignment number 3 is questions. There will be some questions. You need to answer whether the said service is taxable or exempted. And who is liable to pay GST in that case. Okay. So a very, very important area this is. Because repeatedly in exam, they are asking many questions on this. That's why. Okay. So, this assignment number 2 and assignment number 3, today you are going to try. That is the homework for you. Okay. Next. So, renting you understood now. Now, SIR. S for what? Security lending. Supplier is lender of securities. Recipient is borrower of securities. And they need to pay GST on the lending fee. Then, Next one, I, import of services. Then R for renting of motor vehicles. Yes, I R. Next one, C. C for copyright services. We don't have any exemptions in this. No exemptions. There are no exemptions in this here. That's why I'm not referring to any page number. If there are exemptions, I would have referred to the page number. No exemptions. No exemptions. But this point, please try to understand. Copyright services. There are total four copyrights here. There are total four copyrights. What are the total four copyrights? So this copyright services, I'm just explaining little bit in detail. So please concentrate. Copyright services. So what will come in copyright services? What will come in copyright services? Temporary transfer of IPR. It is actually copyright services means temporary transfer of intellectual property rights. Temporary transfer of intellectual property rights. So copyright services. So what will come in this copyright services? Temporary transfer of IPR, intellectual property rights, that will come under copyright services. This copyright services, so total four copyrights I am taking. So first, original literary. Can you give me examples of original literary? Original literary. Can you give me examples of original literary? Sir, in case of supply under section 71C, will GST leviable? Yes, GST will be leviable. How to determine the value? Value will be determined in terms of rules, CGST rules. Okay, fine. So that is a doubt to Visaganar. Now, you tell me examples for original literary. What are the examples for original literary? Books, novels, etc. Books or novels, etc. That is an example of original literary. Then number two, that is dramatic. Dramatic. What is the example of dramatic? Dramatic. Dramatic example. Example of dramatic. Story. Story. Screenplay. Screenplay. That will be coming under dramatic. Okay. Then number three, musical. Musical example. Musical example. So example of musical is songs. Songs. Then background music, albums, etc. Then number four, artistic. Artistic works. Artistic works example. Artistic works example, drawings, drawings, then paintings, paintings, etc. will come under artistic works. Okay. In case of original literary, in case of original literary, who is the supplier? Who is the supplier? Author. Who is the recipient? Publisher. And this will be taxable, no doubt. And we have two options for payment of GST. There are two options for payment of GST. Option one, FCM. FCM means who will pay, darling? FCM means who will pay? Author will pay. Author will pay. Author will pay GST. And option two, who will pay GST? RCM. Option two, RCM. Who will pay GST? Who is the recipient? Publisher. Publisher will pay. Publisher will pay. Please try to understand. Please try to understand. If author pays GST under FCM, there is a lock-in for 1 year. What is the meaning of 1 year lock-in? There is a lock-in for 1 year. What is the meaning of 1 year lock-in? Which means that for 1 year, author only should pay GST under FCM. Generally, which option will be applicable? RCM option. Generally, which option? RCM option. Generally, option 2, RCM. If nothing is given, RCM, recipient will pay. But if supplier opts to pay GST under FCM, FCM means supplier will pay GST to government, forward charge mechanism. RCM means recipient will pay GST to government, that is reverse charge mechanism. When supplier pays GST to government, there is a lock-in for 1 year. Don't forget this. There is a lock-in for 1 year, okay? Whereas in case of dramatic, musical and artistic works, who will pay GST? RCM. Always it will be RCM. Always it will be RCM. That is producer or music company. Producer or music company will pay GST. Whereas the other one is also there. Any other copyright. Any other copyright. Who will pay GST? Any other copyright? Example, patents. Then trademark, technology, etc. Will it be coming under FCM? No. It will be coming under FCM. Yes, it will be coming under FCM. It will not be coming under RCM. Got it? Because that is not given. Only four copyrights are given under RCM. What are those four copyrights? Original literary, dramatic, musical and artistic works. Okay? So, this you can understand. Sir, why a person... Sir, can ITC be availed in option 2? No. See, remember that today, if you pay GST, if your outward supply is covered under RCM, if outward supply is covered under RCM, then ITC cannot be availed on inward supply. Okay, this is something which is very, very important. You should remember. Note, if outward supply is covered under RCM, okay, then ITC cannot be availed on inward supply. ITC cannot be availed on inward supply. Why? Because outward supply covered under RCM is treated as exempted supply for availment of ITC. Because outward supply covered under RCM is treated as exempt supply for availment of ITC under section 17 subsection 3. 17 subsection 3 deals with the meaning of exempted supply. In that meaning of exempted supply, it is given that outward supply covered under RCM is treated as exempted supply. That's the reason why when a person's outward supply is covered under RCM, they cannot take ITC on inward supply. So therefore, in this case, for example, first one, if you see original literary, in case of original literary, if publisher is paying GST, author is not paying GST, can author take ITC with respect to the inward supply? No. That's the reason why author opts to pay GST under FCM, so that they can take ITC on their inward supply. Okay. Then, what are other copyrights? Example, that's what? Patent, technology, Android you take. Android is an example. So, any patent I have, so that is called as copyrights. Okay. Then, sir, most times RCM concept becomes confusing. So, that's why I gave you a keyword and I am giving you a table for you to remember. So, that's the reason why I discussed it separately. Actually, majority of the RCM already I covered in the exemptions. But why I am discussing it separately? Because of that reason only. So, you need to remember this table. Okay. Hardly two pages. Easily you can remember. Okay. Hardly two pages. So, with that keyword, you try to remember. Okay. So, these are the services which are covered under RCM. Then, so copyright services we completed. GTS services. Already we discussed some exemptions with respect to GTS services, correct? So what are the exemptions with respect to GTS service? We discussed in detail here. Refer page number. All GTS services we discussed GTA services, after transportation services we discussed. Yes, page number 65. Refer page number 65. So GTA services, five exemptions. What are they? Notified goods, six notified goods. What are those six notified goods? Agricultural produce, then food grains including flours, pulses, milk and salt, organic manure, newspapers and magazines, relief materials for natural and man-made disasters, defense equipment and materials. So those transportation of notified goods exempted. Then, so single carriage freight does not exceed 1500, and then single consignee freight does not exceed 750. And when the recipient is government, central government, state government, local authority registered only to detect TDS, or if the recipient is unregistered individual or unregistered HF or unregistered AJP not having a factory. These are the five cases it is exempted. In all other cases, it will be taxable, and there are two options. Either they can pay GST under FCM or they can pay GST under RCM. If it is 12% rate FCM, GTA will pay. If it is 5% rate RCM, who will pay? Consignor or consignee will pay. Already we discussed that. Then government or local authority services. Services provided by government to business entities. We discussed na. So government services to business entity. Refer page number 54. Refer page number 54. You can refer there. Page number 54. There I have given. Okay. Page number 54. Here, not this one. The previous one. Refer page number 54. Okay, so this already we discussed. Government or local authority service to business entities. We have 13 specific exemptions. And after that 13 specific exemptions, some general exemptions are there. Two general exemptions are there. And in the remaining case, it will be taxable. Wherever it is taxable. If it is renting of immovable property, if the recipient is registered, recipient will pay. Otherwise, supplier will pay. Any other service, always recipient only will pay. What if the recipient is unregistered? They need to compulsorily get registered for payment of GST. So this already we discussed then. So Sir CG, we completed. Sir CG, Sir, S for security lending, I for import of service, R for renting of motor vehicles, C for copyright services, G for GTA services. Now next, G for government services to business entities. O for overseeing committee services to RBI. So that we discussed in exemptions, overseeing committee, RBI services, we have few exemptions. While discussing banking and other financial services, we discuss this. Okay. So that is in page number 43. Refer page number 43. Refer page number 43. Refer page number 43. So there we discussed. What is that? Overseeing committee services. So overseeing committee providing services to RBI. So this overseeing committee will restructure the NPAs, non-performing assets, for which they will get a commission. On that commission, who will pay GST? On the commission, GST is payable by the recipient, that is RBI. Got it? That is this point here. Then T, transfer of right to use. That is TDR, FSI and long-term lease. Where this we have discussed? We discussed it in construction services. We discussed it in construction services. Some exemption is available with respect to this. Page number 60. Refer page number 60. Sir, please write down all these things. Please write down all these page numbers so that when you are referring this, you can cross check with that. So what is that we have discussed in page that there are TDR, FSA and long term lease, transferable development rights, floor space index and long term lease. So landowner will be giving the TDR, FSA and long term lease to the promoter or builder, and for which the consideration will be received by the landowner. On that consideration, liability to pay GST is on promoter or builder under RCM. Clear or not? And there is an exemption. What is that exemption? So to the extent of residential flats booked before completion certificate, it is exempted. To the extent of residential flats booked before completion certificate, it is exempted. And I have drawn a chart also related to that, and you have made note of that. So you can refer to that. It's already there in the previous lecture. You can refer to that. We discussed it. Okay. Then next, sponsorship services, where we discussed this sponsorship services that BCCI, etc. We have seen BCCI services, etc. Sports related services. Refer page number 57. Refer page number 57. Sports related services we discussed. What is that? Sir, sponsorship services to recognized sporting event is exempted. Unrecognized sporting event or any other event will be taxable. Wherever it is taxable, if the recipient is body corporate or firm, recipient will pay. If the recipient is other than body corporate or firm, supplier will pay. We discussed that. That is sponsorship services. Okay. Sir, CG got we have completed. S for security lending, I for import of services, R for renting of motor vehicles, then C for copyright services, G for GTA services, then GOT, government services to business entities, overseeing committee to RBI, T for transfer of right to use land, that is FSA, TDR and long-term lease. Now last we are discussing salaries. In that, yes, sponsorship services we completed. Then agent services, concentrate, agent services. So total five agents, sir. Total five agents covered under RCM. There is an insurance agent. One second here. One second. There is an insurance agent who provided services to the insurance company. With respect to these services of insurance agent to the insurance company, insurance agent receives some commission. On that commission, who will pay GST? Insurance company will pay GST. Okay, that is this insurance agent to person carrying insurance business. Recovery agent to banking company or financial institution or NBFC. There is a recovery agent who will be working for bank financial institution by way of recovering the outstanding loans, etc., for which he gets a commission. On that commission, who will pay GST? Bank company or banking company or financial institution or NBFC will pay GST. Then direct selling agent, what they will do? They will market the banking products, or you need any loans, you need any credit cards. So they will torture like anything. So these people are known as direct selling agents other than body corporate or firm. So direct selling agent should be other than body corporate or firm, and they are providing services to the banking company and they get a commission. On that commission, GST is payable by the banking company. What if the direct selling agent is body corporate or firm? It is not covered under RCM. Very important. If the direct selling agent is body corporate or firm, it will not come under RCM. It will come under FCM only. So there should be direct selling agent should be other than body corporate or firm. Then this business facilitator to banking company, agent of business correspondent to banking company, we already discussed. These two points already discussed. Okay, where we discussed it in banking services. We discussed this in banking services here. Hope you remember this. This we discussed in banking services. Refer page number 45. Refer page number 45. Even chart, two charts also I have drawn. That is business correspondent or business facilitator or agent of business correspondent or agent of business facilitator to banking company in rural area is exempted, whereas in urban area will be taxable. Always business correspondent only will pay GST, and business facilitator will never pay GST. So business facilitator services will be covered under RCM. If any person is providing service to business facilitator also, it will be FCM. Whereas business correspondent reverse, always business correspondent only will pay GST. Two charts we have seen a discussion related to this. Then legal services, so some big information is there about legal services which we have discussed. Do you remember? Services by individual advocate, firm of advocate other than senior advocate, then services by senior advocate. So that discussion already we have made. So refer page number 61. You refer page number 61, you can find the information related to this. Okay. Same way, arbitrator service also. Arbitrator service also. Refer page number 61. then director services to body corporate. So this point we discussed, and I connected this with one circular also. There is one circular also regarding this. There is one circular also regarding this. Hope you remember that circular. What is that circular here? One second. What is that circular? Sir, there is a director, sir, who is getting money come from a company, and whatever money that a director receives from the company, and on that, whether GST applicable or not, we saw one circular. That circular is actually in the first chapter. Okay. So that circular is in the not first chapter, second chapter, I think. But we discussed, I remember discussing this with you here. Yes, discussed. Page number 31. Refer page number 31. Director services to company or body corporate. Refer page number 31. I discussed this already. Refer page number 31. I discussed. I told you. Whatever money that is paid by the company to the director, if it is chargeable to DTS, sorry, if it is chargeable to TDS under section 92, if TDS is deductible under section 92, then it will be coming under salary. So salary means it is excluded from supply. Suppose if any payment is made by the company to the director is chargeable to TDS under 194J, then in that case, that will not come under salary for the director. So on that, GST will be applicable, where liability to pay GST is not on the director, but on the company or body corporate. So director service to company or body corporate is covered under RCM. Then last one, security services. We don't have any exemption related to security services. So this is the last one here. So what is that security services point? That is security service, security agency is there. That security agency is other than body corporate. Concentrate. Security agency is other than body corporate. And if the recipient is registered but not opting for composition scheme or not registered just to deduct DDS, then the recipient will pay GST. Suppose if the supplier is body corporate, it will be FCM. Why? Supplier should be other than body corporate. Okay. Why in the second case also it is FCM? Because the recipient is unregistered. Okay. Why third case also it is FCM? Even though recipient is registered, they are opting for composition scheme. Okay. Why fourth case also FCM? Even though recipient is registered, but they are registered only to deduct TDS. In remaining case only, RCM will be applicable. In remaining case only, RCM will be applicable, and liability to pay GST is on recipient. Okay. So this is about Sir CG got salads. These are the services where liability to pay GST is on recipient. Okay. So one quickly, I'm just revising it. Yes, for security lending, liability to pay GST is on lend borrower of the securities. I for import of service, recipient should pay GST. And R for renting of motor vehicles, three conditions. Supplier should be other than body corporate, recipient should be body corporate, and a rate of GST should be 5%. Then C, copyright services, three copyrights, four copyrights, original literary, dramatic, musical, and artistic works. It will come under RCM, but for original literary, there is an option to pay GST under FCM, but with a lock-in period of 1 year. And then G for GTA services, two options are available, either FCM or RCM. If it is FCM, 12%. If it is RCM, 5%. Then another G, government services to business entities. And O for overseeing committee services to RBI. And T for transfer of right to use land, that is TDR, FSI, and long-term lease. Then salads. S for sponsorship service, recipient should be body corporate or firm, otherwise it will be FCM. A for agents, five agents, insurance agent to insurance company, recovery agent to bank or financial institution, direct selling agent other than body corporate or firm to bank or financial institution, then business facilitator to banking company, agent of business correspondent to business correspondent, five agents. Then L for legal service, service provided by individual advocate, including senior advocate or firm of advocate to business entity. Then A for arbitrator services to business entity. Then D for director services. Director services to business, director services to company or body corporate. Then S is security agency services. In case of security agency services, liability to pay GST is on the recipient who is registered. So supplier should be other than body corporate, recipient should be registered, not for composition scheme and not just to deduct TDS, other cases. Okay. So this is about RCM under section 9 subsection 3. Done here. So in these cases, who will pay GST? Recipient will pay GST. So have a look into few questions which we did not discuss in the previous chapter that is connected to liability to pay GST. Okay. So that is question number 9 in page number 84. In the previous concept block, take the previous concept block. In the previous concept block, we have question number 9. Have a look into that question number 9. Decide which person is liable to pay GST in the following independent cases where the recipient is located in the taxable territory. Ignore the aggregate turnover and exemption that is available. Mr. Raghu provides sponsorship services to Vivin Cricket Academy, an LLP. So, Raghu provided sponsorship services to Vivin Cricket Academy and LLP. So recipient is LLP, body corporate or firm including LLP. Then will it come under RCM or not? Yes, it will come under RCM. It will come under RCM. Sponsorship services will come under RCM if the recipient is body corporate or firm including LLP. Therefore, it will be coming under reverse charge mechanism. Then Safetrans, a goods transport agency, transported goods of Kapil and Co, a partnership firm which is not registered under GST. Now listen carefully. GTA provided services to a partnership firm. Actually, exemption is for whom? Only to individual HUF or AJP who are unregistered. But if the partnership firm is unregistered, even then it will be taxable. And liability to pay GST is on that partnership firm under RCM, and that partnership firm should compulsorily get registered. Alternatively, GTA also can pay GST under forward charge mechanism. So what is that we need to write for the first one? First, you need to give the reference. What is that reference? As per section 9, subsection 3, read with notification number 13, 2017. Sponsorship services provided to body corporate or firm, including LLP, is covered under reverse charge mechanism. In the present case, the recipient is LLP, therefore, liability to pay GST is on the recipient under RCM, like that. Second one, what you will write? So GTA services to an unregistered partnership firm is not exempted and it will be taxable. Consequently, there are two options for payment of GST. So GTA can pay GST under FCM or they can make the recipient to pay GST under RCM. In the present case, the recipient is unregistered, but they are compulsorily required to get registered to pay GST. Like this, you need to write the answer. Understood? Then one more question also we did not discuss. Question number 4, page number 80. Question number 4, page number 80. Please take question number 4, page number 80. Mr. Vicky Franklin, an unregistered famous author, received 3 crore of consideration from Shiv Bhavan Publications, located in Indore, for supply of service by way of temporary transfer of copyright relating to original literary of the works of his new book. Original literary, copyright related to original literary, somewhere we discussed where it will come, RCM. There are two options now. He finished his work and made available the book to the publisher, but he has not yet raised the invoice. And for your information, please see the first line that he is an unregistered person, author is unregistered. So definitely he will not go for option one, FCM. He will not go for option one. Okay. Then Mr. Vicky Franklin is of the view that SBP is liable to pay tax under reverse charge on the services provided by him. Vicky Franklin is of view, if of the view that SBP is liable to pay GST, correct, under RCM. SBP does not concur with this view and is not ready to deposit the tax. They are telling, no, we are not liable to pay GST. Examine whether the view of Mr. Vicky Franklin is correct. Yes. So, whenever the author is not opting to pay GST under FCM, the liability to pay GST is on the publisher under RCM. Okay. Further, if the view of Mr. Vicky Franklin is correct, what is the recourse available with Mr. Vicky Franklin to comply with the requirements of GST law, as SBP has completely refused to deposit the tax? So if Vicky Franklin want to pay GST under FCM, they need to first opt to pay GST under FCM, and once they opt to pay GST under FCM, that will be locked in for a period of 1 year, and they will only pay GST. That is, Vicky Franklin only will pay GST, and now Vicky Franklin is required to register to pay GST, correct? Actually, he's unregistered. Now he's required to register to pay GST. Now you may get a doubt. Sir, he received 3 crores. Then why is he unregistered? He received 3 crores. Then why is he unregistered? Because in registration, we have one point. Whenever the outward supply is fully covered under RCM, the supplier is not required to get registered. He is exempted from registration. When the outward supply of a person is completely covered under RCM, wherein he is not liable to pay GST, but the recipient is liable to pay GST, the supplier is exempted from registration due to that reason. Okay. So we completed this. Now, next, in concept block 4 itself, at the end we have few questions. That is, liability to pay GST is there, na? For that itself, we have few questions, so please take that. So you need to look into page number 103. Page number 103. Now you are going to participate in the discussion, so I want you to respond and give the answers. Okay, done. Come on. So those who are attending live, so participate in the discussion. GST is not payable by recipient of service in the following cases. GST is not payable by recipient. Not payable by recipient is the question. Services provided by way of sponsorship to ABC Limited. Who will pay GST? Services provided by way of sponsorship to ABC Limited. FCM or RCM? FCM or RCM? So, whenever we come across RCM, it is in notification 13 2017. Yes, exactly. Yes. So, FCM or RCM? Service provided by way of sponsorship to ABC Limited. It will come under FCM or RCM. It will be good. RCM. RCM, not FCM. Services supplied by a director of Galaxy Limited to Mr. Krishna. Service supplied by director of Galaxy Limited to Mr. Krishna. Director of Galaxy Limited to Mr. Krishna, FCM or RCM? So is the director providing service to body corporate or firm? Sorry, body corporate or company? No. One director of a company providing service to one individual. Where is it given in RCM? It is not given in RCM. It will be FCM only. So don't blindly see director RCM, director RCM like that. No. Director means not always RCM. Read carefully. You know English, na? You know English. And you all know the importance of English also. So many people feel like English is not required, but actually English is required. Exams, you have to read in English, you have to write in English. Okay. So for some people, English is not at all required, but we need. Okay, we need. So services provided by a director of Galaxy Limited to Mr. Krishna. When it will be coming under RCM, director service? Director providing service to body corporate or company is only covered under RCM, but it is not here, so therefore it is FCM. Then next, services by Department of Post by way of Speed Post to MNO Limited. You know, hope you all saw the video recently that is posted, that people started making it viral, and that person has apologized. And that person, when he apologized, I don't know whether you saw the apology video. Like that he said. I don't know what he said also. Okay. So, only thing I saw is apology video. Okay, fine. He apologized. We all will think that it is apology. Even sorry he did not say in English. So that also he said in Hindi. It's okay, fine. He apologized. That is enough for us. Okay. So, therefore, only, but I'm not going to leave this. I'm not going to leave this because already this has been taken to Central Council members also of ICAI. See, first of all, if any Hindi students are there, sorry, don't take it in a wrong sense. Why we need to write exams in Hindi? See, either it should be in English or it should be in all languages. Okay, so this is really correct only now. So what's wrong in that? Either make it English uniform across the country. I'm talking to, like, I'm asking this to the ICAI. It's a mistake of ICAI only. So when ICAI conducts the exams in Hindi medium and English medium only, this problem will happen. Why conduct it in Tamil medium also? Conduct it in Telugu medium, conduct it in Kannada, Marathi, Gujarati, every language you put. So how can you hurt the sentiments of people across the country? There are many languages. So give the question paper in all languages. Let them write. Okay. If at all our people can write in their mother tongue, of course, Tamil, no, not possible. So we will then also will write it in English because we all know how difficult it is to write in Tamil. So that already some of you might have experienced. So therefore, we cannot write it in Tamil. It is better to write it in English. Maybe mix of Tamil and English we can write. Tanglish we can write. Okay. So therefore, let them give na, or let them make it uniform. Only English across the country. All students should write the answers in English only. Then it will be good. Okay. So, institute only makes this stupid nonsense things. So we should tell to them, but no one is listening. So if we tell now, they will say you are anti-Indian. What to do? Okay, fine. See this. Services by Department of Post by way of speed post to MNO Limited. See, Department of Post, is it covered under FCM or RCM? Department of Post Services. Department of Post Services is covered under FCM, not under RCM. Okay. Then, services supplied by a recovering agent to SNSP Bank. Recovery agent of a bank. Recovery agent of a bank is covered under RCM, na? Recovery agent to a bank is covered under RCM. So now, GST not payable by recipient means FCM. Which cases it is FCM? 2 and 3. 2 and 3. So option C is the answer. Okay. Then next. 2 and 3 is the answer here. 2 and 3 is the answer. Then question number 2. XX registered in Delhi purchased books from PC traders. Registered in Uttar Pradesh. Books are exempt from GST. XS arranged the transportation of these books from a goods transport agency which charged a freight of 9,000 for the same. GST is payable at 5% on such GTS services. Which of the following statement is correct in the given context? GST of rupees 450 is payable by XX on reverse charge basis. So 9,000 into 5%, GST of 450 is payable by XX on reverse charge basis. Supply of goods and supply of GTS service is a composite supply, wherein supply of goods is a principal supply. Since principal supply is exempt supply, no tax is payable on the freight. Okay. So is that statement correct? No, wrong. This is incorrect statement. Why option B is incorrect statement? Sir, supply of goods and supply of GTS services may be two or more supplies, but when it will become composite supply, two or more taxable supplies only will become composite supply. Two or more taxable supplies will become composite supply. Then see, since exempt goods are being transported, service provided by GTA for transporting the same is also exempt. Is it so? Like that we discussed. No. So this also is incorrect. This also is incorrect. Why option D is also incorrect? Sir, what is the rate? 5%. 5% means who will pay? Recipient will pay. So GTA will not pay. So that's why it is incorrect. 9,000 into 5%, 450. Who will pay? Recipient will pay. So option A is only correct. Option B is incorrect because so one exempted supply, one taxable supply, it will not become composite supply. Option C is incorrect because if that goods which are transport is exempt, the GTA service is also exempted. Nothing like that. And when the rate is 5%, supplier will not pay GST, recipient will pay GST. Only when the rate is 12%, GTA will pay GST. Okay. So therefore, option A is the answer. If the exams are in regional language, then the southern side result will be more. I don't know all those things. I don't know all those things because just because if it is given in regional language, the result will be good. I don't agree with that fact because ultimately, according to me, see today this profession has got relationship across the country and cross border and across the globe. In English is a language across the globe. English is a common language. So today, see, we are not just passing journal entries. We are not accountants. So chartered accountants are different. So therefore, so across the country, we do lot of dealings. So communication for us plays a major role, and even cross-border transactions also our support is required. English is today common language, so nothing wrong in writing the exams in English. Okay, because I'll tell you my story. See, my mother tongue is Telugu. My mother tongue is Telugu, and for me English is an alien subject because majority of the time I remember that I was writing my, like in my school, it was only Telugu, only Telugu medium only. So even normal subjects also we used to write it in Telugu up to primary, like up to secondary, up to seventh standard, up to sixth, seventh standard. And English was never an importance, and even communication was not in English. So I felt a lot, I felt a lot, and I was not knowing how to speak in English properly. Many people used to laugh. Initial days I'm talking about. But today, if I'm able to take classes in English, so because I'm able to take class in English, I'm surviving now. And this profession requires it to be in English. So better to write the exams in English. That Hindi needs to be eliminated. That only should be there. And pass percentage in North versus pass percentage in South, you can never compare. See, basically, there is a difference between our education and their education. So their education will be like the time spent on education is high. Here the time spent on education is less. That's true. Because I have seen many North faculties who are taking classes, they will take one subject in 200 hours, 250 hours, and they will be preparing for one full year and they will be writing the exams. But here, we will not be like that. We will be so like we will not be reading that much in detail and all. So we'll try to somehow clear. That is our objective. So that much time we will not be spending. Okay. But I'm not talking about pass percentage, all these things. So whatever it may be, but what I'm trying to convey is that so let's have a common language for communication. So that is what I mean to say. So don't take this discussion in a different way. Okay. Fine. See this third one. Which of the following services do not fall under reverse charge provisions as contained under Section 9, Subsection 3 of the CGST Act? Service supplied by arbitral tribunal to business entity. So, which of the following does not fall under reverse charge? Now, A is FCM or RCM. A is FCM or RCM. RCM, very good. Why? Services supplied by arbitral tribunal to business entity, RCM. Sponsorship service to any partnership firm, RCM. Sponsorship services to body corporate also, RCM. Service of renting of motor vehicle for passengers provided to recipient other than body corporate. Renting of motor vehicles, when it will come under RCM? Only when the recipient is body corporate. Here the recipient is other than body corporate. So it will come under FCM. Renting of motor vehicles, when it will come under RCM? The recipient should be body corporate. Supplier should be other than body corporate. Recipient should be body corporate. But here the recipient is not body corporate. Other than body corporate, so it will not come under RCM. It will come under FCM. Option D is the answer. Then, in case of GTA services, tax to be paid under forward charge if GST is payable at the rate of 12%, GTA tax is payable under forward charge if GST payable at 12, GST payable at 5, an unregistered individual end customer is the recipient, then it is exempted. Then it is exempted. A registered casual taxable person is the recipient. No, first case. Once the rate of GST is 12%, automatically it will be coming under FCM. Option A. 4, it is A. When GTA will pay GST under FCM? If the rate is 12%, definitely it will be FCM. So these are the questions related to, these are the questions related to MCQs related to liability to pay GST. Now look into some more questions. Two questions are there. Question number 1. In the following independent cases, decide who is liable to pay GST, if any. You may assume that recipient is located in the taxable territory. Ignore the aggregate turnover and exemption available. Weir Transport, a registered goods transport agency paying IGST at the rate of 12%, transported goods by road of Dilip and Company, a sole proprietary firm other than specified person which is not registered under GST or any other law. So GTA paying GST at 12%, transported goods by road. Okay, so now who will pay GST in this case? GTA, FCM. Why? Sir, what is the rate, sir? 12%. So GTA will pay GST under forward charge. Okay, so tax is payable by under forward charge by Weir Transport, a registered GTA. Got it? Then next, number 2, Mr. Kamal Jain, actually it is not A and B, this is the question and this is the answer. From this it is the answer. So there is some typing error. So this is the question, these 2 points are the question and this is the answer. Look into second one. Mr. Kamal Jain, an unregistered famous author, received 20 lakhs of consideration from Peacock Publications Limited for supply of services by way of temporary transfer of copyright covered under section 13(1)(a) relating to original literary work of his new book. Unregistered famous author, unregistered famous author, unregistered author. So supplier is unregistered, then it will be RCM. So actually in case of temporary transfer of IPR relating to original literary, there are 2 options. Either supplier can pay GST or publisher can pay, recipient can pay GST. But here the author is unregistered. So where from they can go to payment of GST under FCM. So therefore it will be RCM. So the publisher, PQR Publications Limited, is only liable to pay GST under RCM. Okay. So 2 points given for 4 marks. In November 2020 exam, the recently conducted November 2020 exam, this asked for 4 marks, 2 points, 2 marks each, easy. Then next, this is given in May 21 RTP, your May 21 RTP, see that, this is related to the director circular. Mr. Priyam, director of Sun Moon Company Private Limited, provide service to company for remuneration of ₹1,25,000. Briefly answer whether GST is applicable in the below mentioned independent cases. If yes, who is liable to pay GST? Mr. Priyam is an independent director of Sun Moon Company Private Limited and not an employee of the company. So will that 1,25,000 be treated as supply? Yes. So that will be treated as supply under section 71A, and it is taxable. And who will pay GST? RCM. That is company will pay. Company will pay. Okay. Next, number two. Mr. Priyam is an executive director. That is an employee of the Sun Moon Company Private Limited. Employee. Out of the total remuneration amounting to 1,25,000, 60,000 has been declared as salaries in the books of Sun Moon Company Private Limited and subject to TDS under 192. So this 60,000 rupees is not a supply. This 60,000 rupees is not a supply, excluded from supply. Correct? Why? Because that 60,000 rupees TDS is computed under 192. However, 65,000 has been declared separately other than salaries under 194J. So therefore, this 65,000 will become supply under section 71A, and it will be taxable and it will be coming under RCM. So who will pay? Sun Moon Company Private Limited will pay. Literally, this illustration is based on the circular. So if you know that circular, you can write this answer. Okay. This is the answer. This is the question. Whatever is given, this is not question number three. This is the answer for that question number two. This is the answer for that question number two. Okay. So how to write the answer, sir? So I am expecting this question here. How to write the answer? Simple. First, you need to write about section 7, subsection 2, Redwood Schedule 3. As per section 7, subsection 2, Redwood Schedule 3 of CGST Act, services by employee to employer in the course of employment is excluded from supply. So that information you need to write. Okay. And then after writing that, next point, what you will write is that. So as per CBIC circular, if any amount is paid by the company to the director, is chargeable to TDS under section 192 and is taxable as salaries in the hands of the director, then it is excluded from supply and not chargeable to GST. If the amount payable by the company to the director is chargeable to TDS under section 194J of Income Tax Act, then it will be treated as, it will be taxable under PGBP or IFOS in the hands of the director, and it will not be excluded from supply and it will be treated as supply and chargeable to GST. Then you write the answer. So in the first case, it is supply and RCM. In the second case, 60,000 and 65,000, what is the treatment? So that's how you need to present the answer. Understood? Clear here? So these are the questions that is given on liability to pay GST under section 9 subsection 3. There is one exception to 9 subsection 3 here. There is one exception to 9 subsection 3. This is that exception. But actually, IGST portion is omitted. IGST portion is omitted. That's why this is not applicable. But why to take risk? We will discuss this. So this is the exception to section 9 subsection 3. So please take page number 97. You can see that chart. Exception to section 9.3. What is this? Sir, as per 9 subsection 3, who is liable to pay GST? As per section 9 subsection 3, liability to pay GST, to government is on whom? To government is on recipient. Okay, correct? Liability to pay GST to government is on recipient as per section 9 subsection 3. Now, there is one service, transportation of goods by vessel. Say there is an exporter of goods who is located outside India. There is an exporter of goods. There is an exporter of goods. And this exporter of goods is located in Germany. This exporter of goods is located in Germany. Okay. And there is importer of goods. Where is that importer of goods located? In India. There is an importer of goods. And that importer of goods is located in India. There is an exporter of goods who is located in Germany. And there is an importer of goods who is located in India. Now, there is import of goods. This import of goods, there is import of goods, and this import of goods is chargeable to customs duty, correct? This import of goods chargeable to customs duty. Chargeable to customs duty. So, therefore, about that we don't have to bother. And with respect to this import of goods, who is the supplier of goods? Who is the supplier of goods? The supplier of goods is exporter of goods, and the recipient of goods, the recipient of goods is importer of goods. Up to this clear? Now, how the goods need to be sent to India? How the goods needs to be sent to India? So exporter approached one shipping company. Where is that shipping company located? That shipping company is also located in Germany. Exporter of goods approached one shipping company, and that shipping company is also in Germany. That shipping company is also in Germany, and that shipping company provided services to exporter of the goods. By way of what? By way of transport of goods from Germany to India. So what service is provided? Transportation of goods service. Transportation of goods service. From where to where? From Germany to India. From Germany to India, they are transporting the goods. Okay. So, from Germany to India, they are transporting the goods by what mode? So, goods are transported by vessel. Goods are transported by vessel. Okay. Transportation of goods service by vessel. From where to where? From Germany to India. From Germany to India. Now, in this context, for these services, who is the supplier of service? Sir, this shipping company is supplier of service. This shipping company is supplier of service. Whereas, this exporter of goods is recipient of service. So the shipping company is supplier of service and exporter of goods is recipient of service. Both supplier as well as recipient are outside India. Both supplier of service is outside India, recipient of service also outside India. Got it? Both are outside India. But it will be taxable. But this service is taxable. Then sir, who will pay GST? This service is taxable. No doubt. This service is taxable. Then who will pay GST? This service is taxable. Who will pay GST? In one corner, one person is sitting. Now one bakra. Make him to pay tax. GST payable to government. GST payable to government. By whom? By importer of goods. Sir, that importer of goods is neither supplier of service nor recipient of service. Just because he is importing goods, you are asking him to pay GST on the freight. On the freight, GST payable to government on ocean freight. On ocean freight, okay. So he is happily living in one corner in India. Now you are asking him to pay GST on that freight. Why he need to pay GST? Only Nirmala Chechi knows. No one knows. Only she should tell. Why importer has to pay GST? What logic is this? That importer of goods is neither supplier of service nor recipient of service, but that importer of goods is liable to pay GST on that services. Okay. So this we discussed. Maybe it is a repetition. Sorry, I forgot what I discussed. Extremely sorry. Fine. But this is the exception which we have already discussed. It's good. So that we discussed. Done. Now we are moving on to section 9 subsection 4. What is this 9 subsection 4? Sir, there is a promoter or builder. That promoter or builder is making inward supplies from an unregistered person. That promoter or builder is registered? Yes. There is a promoter or builder who is making inward supplies from an unregistered person. And on those inward supplies, promoter or builder is liable to pay GST under RCM. Sir, generally why we buy from an unregistered person? To save tax. But in this case, promoter or builder is purchasing from unregistered person to save the tax. But government don't want that to happen. Government want revenue, GST revenue. So what they are telling, you should buy from registered person. If you buy from registered person, you will pay GST to me, to him, and he will pay GST to us. But if you buy from an unregistered person, you are not paying any GST because he is unregistered. Then it is a loss of revenue to the government. So pay GST under RCM. Got it? Got it? So a person that is builder, promoter or builder, who is having inward supplies from an unregistered person is required to pay GST under RCM. Sir, but there are some inward supplies which naturally needs to be received from an unregistered person. Like bricks, sand and all, we cannot buy from a registered person. Bricks, sand, manpower supply service like that, these are all usually received from an unregistered person. Then on that also, whether we need to pay GST under RCM. Okay, fine. I will give you some relaxation. Like that government gave some relaxation. How much? 20% of the total inward supplies in a financial year. So this calculation should be made for a financial year. So total inward supplies during a financial year, 20% we can receive from an unregistered person. But 80% we should purchase from a registered person only. And we have exception to this. Cement. Cement always should be purchased from a registered person. Means in that 20% you cannot keep cement. Suppose in that 20% cement is there, definitely you need to pay GST under RCM. Okay. So that is this 9 subsection 4. So this 9 subsection 4, we are discussing till date, not even one question is asked on 9 subsection 4, but it is there in the study material. So it is there in the study material. So not yet asked in exam till date. So but we will be learning it. Maybe for May 21 exam, if it happens, don't hold me if it happens. Okay. So then it may come. Otherwise, November 21, definitely it will come. Okay. Fine. See this. Sir, for November 21 exam, what should we do, sir? Same year. Don't worry. Because the number of amendments for May 21 and November 21, May 21 to November 21, whatever number of amendments are less in number only. And I will discuss that also, those amendments for November 21 also as a last video. So these videos are equally useful for November 21 exam also. Don't worry. Okay. So see this. Sir, will the exam happen or not? I want it to happen, personally. Personally, I want it to happen. Yes, because you know this is not a good sign to just like that to cancel the exams. So I want it to happen, and I'm pretty much sure that these exams will happen in July. I'm sure because May already, of course, the number of cases are in peak. But by June, the situation will become normal. So July, definitely they will be conducting the exam for sure. Okay. Because otherwise things will go haywire. So that will not happen. Whatever you are thinking right now will not happen. Exam will definitely be there. Don't worry. So either it will be in July or August, but for sure. May not be in May, may not be in June, but definitely it will be in July or August. Don't worry about it. So exams will happen because already many students could not write it in Jan 21. So they could not write in November 20. They could not write it in Jan 21. Now they are about to write in May 20. If that is not happening, that's too much. So that's why to give an opportunity they will give. But definitely opt out will come. Definitely opt out will come. And again, many students may go for November 21. So all these things will happen, but we don't have to bother about it. These lectures, whatever I'm taking now, whatever book that you have, will be equally applicable for November 21 also. And I will give you the extra PDF containing the amendments and illustrations on the amendments. That is sufficient. So therefore, just keep that illustrations and amendments and this book, and you can happily prepare for November 21 exam. Okay. If the exam did not happen for May 21, don't worry. Happens also, don't worry. This will be applicable for November 21 also. Okay, fine. Will online exam come? I don't think so. CA Institute will conduct online exams and all. They are not good at it. Because if online exam is conducted, they cannot fail a student. Not possible. So completely result will increase. Whatever has happened for CMA exam, like that it will happen. So CMA exams not an issue because already the pass percentage was less for many years. So once when the pass percentage increase, that will not have any problem. But CA, no, definitely it will be risky for the institute, so they will not do that. Because they know all students will clear if it is online exam. Because CMA exams, many students have followed many malpractices and cleared. I know that. Okay. So online exams, we can cheat easily. So that's why they will not conduct. Don't worry. Fine. Say this. Invert supply of a promoter or builder will be divided into three. Invert supplies of a promoter or builder is divided into three. Capital goods, first inputs, input services, and capital goods. Say again, I'm repeating, 9 subsection 4 is now applicable only to, 9 subsection 4 is applicable only to promoter or builder. 9 subsection 4 is applicable only to promoter or builder. Now, what we need to do? Divide the invert supplies of promoter or builder into three. That is inputs, input services, capital goods. First, see capital goods. Capital goods should always be purchased from a registered person. If capital goods is purchased from an unregistered person, GST is payable under RCM at the rate applicable to capital goods. GST payable under RCM at the rate applicable to capital goods. Got it? GST payable under RCM at the rate applicable to that capital goods. If capital goods are purchased from unregistered person. So, for example, a machinery, a concrete mixer, etc., is purchased, and the rate of that is 12 means 12 we need to pay under RCM, 18 means 18 we need to pay under RCM. That is in case of capital goods. Very, very simple. Now, take inputs. From inputs, you take out few inputs on which, even if you buy from an unregistered person, it's okay. You don't have to pay any GST. What are they? High speed electricity, high speed diesel, motor spirit, and natural gas. Electricity, high speed diesel, motor spirit, and natural gas. So these four you exclude. Electricity, high speed diesel, motor spirit, and natural gas you exclude. This, even if the promoter or builder is receiving from an unregistered person, it's okay. Other inputs divide into two. Purchased from a registered person more than 80. Purchased from a registered person more than 80 means, say for example, purchased from registered person is 88%. Now, what is the baki purchased from unregistered person? 12%. Baki purchased from unregistered person is 12%. Now, in that if cement is there, you need to pay GST and RCM at the rate of 28%. For cement, what is the rate? 28%. So, in that 12%, if cement is there, I told you cement is an exception. Always we need to pay GST and RCM on cement. So, we need to pay GST at the rate of 28% on cement. If it is other goods, no need to pay any GST and RCM because already we achieved 80%. Suppose if purchases from registered person is less than 80, say 65%. Purchases from registered person less than 80, say 65%. 65%. Purchases from registered person less than 80, say 65%. Balance purchased from unregistered person is how much? 35%. In that, shortfall up to 80. What is the shortfall up to 80? 15% is the shortfall up to 80, correct? Shortfall up to 80% is 15%. And beyond 80% is 20%. Shortfall up to 80, that is 15%. Beyond 80%, that is 20%. Shortfall up to 80, that 15%, if it is cement, pay GST and RCM at the rate of 28%. If it is other goods, pay GST and RCM at the rate of 18%. 18%, if it is other goods, 18%. Sir, up to 80 you should have purchased from registered person. If you buy less than 80 from a registered person, whatever is that shortfall, you have to pay GST and RCM. Let it be cement or other goods. If it is cement, pay 28%. If it is other goods, pay 18%. Suppose if you have achieved 80, beyond 20, like beyond, that is, once you pay GST and RCM on that 15, now you achieved 80. Already 65. Now on that 15, you pay GST and RCM. So you achieved 80. Now remaining 20. Remaining 20, whether cement is there or not, you check. If cement is there, you need to pay GST and RCM at the rate of 28. Otherwise, no need to pay any GST. So, this is in case of inputs. In case of input services, very simple. We don't have cement and all in input services. From input services, you take out TDR, FS and long-term lease. Why? Because on TDR, FS and long-term lease, anyhow GST is payable under RCM under 9.3. On TDR, FS and long-term lease, anyhow GST is payable under 9.3. So therefore, that you take out anyhow on the GST payable under RCM. Remaining services. From a registered person, greater than 80%. No need to pay any GST under RCM because we achieved 80%. Suppose if purchase from a registered, invert supply from a registered person is less than 80, shortfall up to 80, whatever is there on that, you need to pay GST under RCM at 18%. And beyond 80%, GST not payable under RCM. That is this. Whenever you do the computation, you need to do the computation separately for capital goods and together for inputs and input services. Please see this. Inputs and input services should be considered together for computation, and capital goods should be considered separately. And this will be computed separately for each project. For each project, it will be computed separately. Now, sir, I purchased for one project, used for other project. Leave it. Don't see the usage. See for which project you have purchased. Then, computed for each financial year. For every financial year, we will compute this. This is not computed on a monthly basis. This is computed on a yearly basis. Suppose if the project is completed in part of the year, up to the project completion date. Now, this concept of 9 subsection 4, we need to see with the help of an illustration. So that illustration I will share. Okay. So actually they did not ask any past exam question related to 9 subsection 4. But if at all they ask a question, how it will be? So I created one question and that question we will solve. I will explain that question because we don't have a past exam question in that. Due to that reason, One second, I'll just take that information. Just give me one second here. I'll take that PDF. Somewhere it is there. Yes. See, this illustration I will share with you. Don't worry. Actually, this illustration I created for final students, but this is equally applicable. Maybe at inter level also it can be asked. So see this illustration and I will share it in your Google Drive. I'll share it in your Google Drive. See this illustration. A promoter has procured the following goods and services for construction of a residential real estate project during a financial year. Name of the input goods and services. This is the list of input goods and services. Rate of GST is there. And value of invoice supply is there, whether received from a registered person or unregistered person, data is there. Now, so this is received from a registered person. Now go through this question carefully. Just go through this question carefully. Like this, a question will be given in exam. Now they will ask, compute GST payable under RCM. Compute GST payable under RCM. Compute GST payable under RCM under section 9(3) and 9(4) of CGST Act. Like this, if they give a question for 5 marks, they may give you this question for 5 marks or 6 marks like that. Now, what is that we need to do? Sir, again I am repeating, on 9-4, they have not framed a question till date. But if at all they frame a question, that question will be like this. Okay, now, in this, what is that we need to do? First step, 9-3 you take, 9-3 you take. FSI, in this list, where 9-3 will come? On FSI 9-3 will come, correct? On FSI 9-3 will come. On TDR, FSI and long term lease 9-3 will come. On that, GST is payable by promoter or builder under reverse charge mechanism. So that we are writing first. GST payable by promoter. GST payable. By promoter, GST payable by promoter under RCM under section 9 subsection 3 with respect to FSI. What is that? So 5 lakhs. 5 lakhs is the value. On that 5 lakhs, 18%. So that is equals to 90,000. Over. Done. Now next. So 9-3 we completed. And this FSI you ignore. This FSI you ignore. Why? Because 9-3 we paid on FSI. Now next heading. GST payable by promoter. So this is how you need to write in exam also. Okay. GST payable by promoter under RCM under section 9 subsection 4 first capital goods. I told you for capital goods you need to do the treatment separately. First see the capital goods. Is there capital goods in the list? Is there capital goods in the list? Yes. And that capital goods we purchased from RP or unregistered person, RP or unregistered person, registered or unregistered person. That capital goods we purchased from an unregistered person. On that we need to pay GST under RCM 9-4 at what rate? At 12% at the rate applicable to capital goods purchased from unregistered person, capital goods purchased from unregistered person. What is the capital goods purchased from unregistered person? So what is the value you take? 40 lakhs. 40 lakhs into 12%. 40 lakhs into 12%. 40 lakhs into 12%. That equals to 4,80,000. 4,80,000. Okay. 40 lakhs into 12%. The rate applicable to capital goods you need to take. This is capital goods purchased from an unregistered person. Now, take inputs. Take inputs and input services together. So capital goods also removed into discussion. You remove that capital goods also in the discussion. Now, inputs and input services other than electricity, diesel, petrol. So don't take electricity into the discussion. Don't take electricity into the discussion. Don't take electricity into the discussion. It should not come. Then remaining UC, remaining inward supplies. Both inputs and input services. Calculate the total. What is the total of this? I want you to do the calculator total and tell me. What is the total of this? What is the total of this? What is the total of this? Other than inputs, that is input inputs and input services other than electricity, FSI, TDR, motor spirit, petrol, diesel, and capital goods. What is that inputs and input services total in a year? How much it is? 10 plus 15 plus 20 plus 15 plus 10 plus 5 plus 10 plus 20 plus 15. How much? 120 lakhs. 120 lakhs. 120 lakhs, 120 lakhs. Now, what is purchased from unregistered person? I'll make a small change. So this manpower supply is there, na? That is purchased from unregistered person. Okay. Manpower supply is purchased from unregistered person. Now, what is purchased from unregistered person? 15 and 20. 15 and 20. Now, so, what is the purchases from unregistered person? 35 out of 120. But in that cement is there. In that cement is there. So, on cement, always you need to pay GST under RCM if you buy from an unregistered person. Correct or not? Yes, sir. So, cement purchased from an unregistered person. Cement purchased from unregistered person. How much? How much is cement purchased from unregistered person? 15 lakhs. 15 lakhs into what is the rate? 28% you take. Why 28% you need to take? Because for cement, always we need to take 28%. Is it purchased from unregistered person? Yes. So don't see 80, 20 and all. Don't see 80, 20 and all because cement, always you need to purchase from a registered person. So 15 lakhs into 28%. 15 lakhs into 28%. How much? 4,20,000. 4,20,000. Okay. 15 lakhs into 28%. 4,20,000. Now you see balance purchases from unregistered person. Balance purchase from unregistered person. Balance purchase of inward supply. Balance purchase of inward supply from unregistered person. Inward supply from URP. From URP is how much? Manpower supply 20 lakhs. 20 lakhs out of total 120 lakhs. 20 out of 120 lakhs is how much? 20 out of 120 is how much? 20 divided by 120. So 16 point 67%, which is less than or equal to 20%. Therefore, GST not payable under RCM. GST not payable under RCM under section 9 subsection 4 on the balance as purchases from RP exceeds 80% of total inputs and input services. So therefore, what is the GST payable under 9 subsection 4? 4,80,000 and 4,20,000. So GST payable under RCM under section 9.4. Total GST payable under RCM under section 9.4 equal to 4,80,000 and 4,20,000, 9 lakhs, correct? Okay, so flooring tiles also is there, fine. Now you take, okay. Flooring tiles is also there, flooring tiles is also there, 10 lakhs. Now it will change, okay, up to this you understood now? Up to this you understood. Now, if flooring tiles is there, let's see what will happen. Flooring tiles means, just take 30 lakhs. Take 30 lakhs here. 30 divided by 120, what is the percentage? 30 divided by 120, what is the percentage? 30 lakhs divided by 120, 30 divided by 120, that is 25%, which is greater than 20%. Now, so on 5% of 120 lakhs, what is 5% of 120 lakhs? That is, sir, why sir? Sir, only 20% is allowed. Remaining is not allowed to be purchased from an unregistered person. So what is that? 120 into 5%. So 120 lakhs into 5% is 6 lakhs. On 5% of rupees 120 lakhs, that is 6 lakhs. GST payable under RCM 9 subsection 4. GST payable equals to GST payable under section 9 subsection 4 at 18%. So 6 lakhs into 18%. 6 lakhs into 18%. So 6 lakhs into 18% is 1,08,000. 1,08,000. So total GST payable under RCM 9 subsection 4. Total GST payable under RCM, under section 9.4. So how much? 1,08,000, 4,20,000 plus 4,80,000. So 10,08,000 will be taken. Okay. 10,08,000 will be taken. Sir, always on cement you need to pay GST under RCM, but wait. So cement don't count now. Now already you paid GST on cement. So 10 and 20, these two are only purchased from unregistered person. So 10 and 20 is 30. So 30 divided by 120, 25%, which exceeds 20%. So on that 5% of 120 lakhs, that is 6 lakhs, we will pay GST. So 18%, 6 lakhs into 18%, 108 lakhs, so 10,08,000. So this is how you need to calculate. You understood this illustration? Okay. And this illustration I will share in the Google Drive so that you can refer to that. Okay. Along with today's notes, I will share that. You can refer. So today is lecture 7. Today is lecture 7. लेक्चर सेवन ओनली ना? यस लेक्चर सेवन ओनली, डे सेवन ओनली. सो दिस नोट्स अलॉन्ग विद दैट इलुस्ट्रेशन आई विल शेयर. सो टुडे वी कंप्लीटेड द डिस्कशन. Today we completed the discussion related to 9.3 and 9.4. Now only one area is left, that is 9.5. So that 9.5 along with the registration related provisions for 9.5 we will see in the next class. Okay, so these important points along with this 9.5 we will see in the next class. So in the next class, we will be completing 9.5 and I will be starting a new topic, that is value of supply. So we completed the major area, then we will be completing, like we will be looking into value of supply and then time of supply. Okay, thank you. We will meet in the next class.